to the far left, and that is that they rescue us. They don't empower us. We don't do anything our own volition. They define us, they define our class, and they must say that we must stay within that definition. And if we transcend that definition in any way, they say that we are a traitor to it. That's why they adopted so quickly the right-wing rhetoric of the will of the people. But they know the people will lie to over Brexit. But how do they respond to these lies? Not with the truth and with facts, but with more lies. They claim that we can receive all the same benefits at the same time as leaving the EU. They guarantee, contrary to the advice of independent economists and government departments, that they can provide a jobs first Brexit. And what is the secret behind this magical strategy? Well, according to Shami Chakrabarti, it's the love in the room that Jeremy generates. You know, he refused to share a platform with other pro-Remain Labour MPs during the referendum because he didn't agree with them. And I find that really odd because he's often sharing platforms with people that he doesn't necessarily agree with. The point is this, Brexit, be it left or right, is manipulative, it's undemocratic and it's authoritarian. Its priority is its ideology and not the people that it is meant to serve. Thank you.
Wonderful. Now, if you were one of the 700,000 people who marched in October, you may remember a wonderful film. Great you were. Thank you very much. You remember a wonderful film by the great Scottish actor Brian Cox. Well, he's here again with an important message for our MPs and for us about the fight ahead.
Tuesday is the big day. A day of chaos. Lies have been told. Promises have been made, which have led us to this point of no return. But there is a return to the people's vote. The world of today is not the world of 2016. Our government is asking us to support a deal which they freely admit will make us poorer and weaker as a country. A deal which both camps admit is more. It is the people's right that this deal be scrutinised and voted on. Voted by the people, for the people. On Tuesday, when this deal is defeated, as defeated it will be ready for the fight. Because we can and we must win it.
Brian Cox. Ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker is a tireless campaigner. She simply never gives up. And she's someone who is never afraid to stand up for bravery and incredible resilience. Please welcome Luciana Burger, the MP for Liverpool Waverley.
Because the future of our country is at stake. I'm here today from Liverpool on behalf of my constituents and a city who didn't vote to become poorer. They do not deserve, and our country does not deserve, at least a decade more of Brexit austerity. I've heard from hundreds and hundreds of people who are appalled at what is going on. And just last night I heard from David, a local resident, who put it like this in an email to me. He said, "It is clear that leaving the EU is going to adversely affect the poorest in our society. I did not vote to be poorer, diminish the future prospects of my children, damage the relationship with our most important trade partner, weaken the NHS, drop out of international scientific collaborations, diminish the protection of workers' rights, become less secure, or risk access to the supply of safe food and medicines." I couldn't agree more. But I'm also here today not just as a Member of Parliament, but as a mum, and as you might have been able to see, with another baby shortly due. Now, I've been told to slow down, it's the third trimester, take it easy. But I will not stand idly by and spectate a disaster unfold. I will not be a bystander. For any parent or grandparent asking, what should we do in this crisis? The first thing you think of, as David pointed to last night, is your children. How will Theresa May's plan affect their future? We have long achieved an aim in our country where each new generation does better than the last. Today, we can't now guarantee the next generation the same opportunities we've all enjoyed. And let's be clear what the sponsors of Brexit, the reckless gang who made this country a raft of empty, unbelievable promises, what do they have in mind for children and young people? These are the very same people who have seen the closures of hundreds of children's centres and youth services, who stopped countless school building refurbishments, abolished educational maintenance allowance, and trebled tuition fees. That is what Gove, Fox, Johnson and their clan have actually done already to young people. For this mess, and above all, I don't believe that the majority voted to withhold future generations the opportunities we have all come to expect and sometimes taken for granted. Now, some do say that they are prepared to deny their children or grandchildren these economic opportunities that they've had because they want Brexit at any cost. But I say, what right do we have to deny future generations' prosperity? What right do we have to erect obstacles in their progress, their well-being, and their future success? I say we have no right to do that, none whatsoever. There are 2 million people who are over the age of 18 and can vote today, who did not have their say 2.5 years ago. They are clear that they do not want this. And this is only the people who will be able to resolve the impasse. Now that our country and our nation has the full facts, the actual proposition about exactly what Brexit will entail, including the risks and the uncertainties and the consequences, what exactly they will be. Is Brexit what you thought it would be when you voted either way back in 2016? Now, as an MP, I will be voting against the withdrawal agreement deal on Tuesday. But Parliament alone has already proved itself incapable to solve this. I say let's seize the day. We cannot delay. Now is the moment. Our country and the next generation deserve a final say.
Ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker is a long-time pro-European. He's the MP for Twickenham and leader of the Liberal Democrats. Give it up for Vince Cable.
Well, thank you for your welcome. And thank you for all you've done. Keeping campaigning, keeping the faith. It's because of you that we've got where we are. We've moved from a possibility to a probability. You have heard this morning, even the Cabinet is now talking about a people's vote as a way out of it. And if you don't believe the newspaper, call in at the bookmakers on the way home. They'll give you even money. And it's very clear why we're winning this argument. We've won the argument about the economy already. We can see where Brexit's leading, falling investment, lower confidence, a falling currency, and we've even got the Chancellor accepting now that there's a price to be paid for dividends to be harvested. And they can't solve the Irish problem that we warned about 2 years ago. Democratic Unionists have abandoned the government. The only political organisation which has actually joined up and supported the government's Brexit deal, unbelievably, is Sinn Féin, and they don't have a vote. So some people are trying to find a way out of this with a pretend Brexit. You know, let's have Norway plus. As if people won't notice that they're still paying the membership fee, that we're still following the rules of the European Union without having a vote. It's a nonsense. And an equal nonsense is the idea that we can somehow crash out. If this government were so insane and irresponsible as deliberately crash the economy out, Parliament this week has taken back control. We will not let them do it. Ourselves to be intimidated by the threats of violence. You heard Jeremy Hunt warning of riots. This is the same guy who likened the European Union to the Soviet Union. Completely insane, inflammatory, and dangerous. There's a lot of angry people who want us to stay in the European Union. But we're not threatening to riot. We trust the public. We trust the public to make the final decision on the deal. If we win, we win. If we lose, and we then pull the country together. But we respect the views of the public, and that's why we're fighting for a deal, not for the deal of Theresa May, but her deal versus the choice of staying within the European Union. That is the choice that must have been taken. And we trust the public to do it. Thank you. Let's give a big table.
We have a wonderful speaker next, ladies and gentlemen, the former co-leader of the Green Party and someone who on Channel 4 will be representing the people's vote in the Brexit debate is Caroline Lucas.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for everything that you're doing, everything that you continue to do. And this is such an important moment, as you know. We are standing at the brink of the most important week in recent British political history. The decisions made next week will have consequences that will last for generations, and they go to the heart of the kind of country we want to be and the kind of future we want for our children. So, our message, I think, for Theresa May could not be clearer. We do not want your vision of a mean-minded little Britain with our borders closed and our horizons narrow. We don't want a future that betrays the hopes and dreams of our young people who overwhelmingly want to stay inside the European Union. Britain is better than that. We deserve better than that, and that is why we are demanding a people's vote. And make no mistake, the support for a people's vote is growing and growing. Even just this morning, it was in the Sunday Times, so it must be true. They too are supporting it. Every single constituency in Britain now has a majority for a people's vote, and we know that a majority in that vote would vote to remain inside the EU. Change. The will of the people has changed. The will of the people cannot be undermined by a vote of the people.
And in light of all the new facts that have become available over the last 2 years, in light of the extraordinary spectacle of a government proudly proclaiming that they are going to make the country even poorer, in light of the damage that Brexit will do to our environmental standards, our labour rights, our human rights, in light of the way in which Brexit is meaning that EU citizens who've made their lives here in good faith now fear they are not welcome, we will reject that Brexit because we reject that politics.
Citizens who have made their lives in this country, thank God you have, they have. I was actually in A&E last night, not for myself and my husband, but it's a long story, but the point being that he was pointing out that he was treated first of all by someone from Poland, then by someone from Italy, then by someone from Spain, and they were all amazing. Thank you so much. Because time is running out. First, I think we should be championing and standing up for freedom of movement. I think it's a wonderful gift, not something we should be. And secondly, this campaign for a people's vote is not about defending the status quo. Those people who voted Leave because they believe that our country is wrong, that the policies of this country are going in the wrong direction, that people are being left out from the prosperity that is enjoyed in the cities. Those people were right. But the lie at the heart of Brexit is that the idea of leaving the EU would make it easier to tackle all of those problems. We know we are a country of grotesque inequality, but that is why we have to make sure we do not make our country weaker, we do not make us poorer. What we have to do going forward together is to make sure that we invest in those areas of that country. We need to make sure that we have hope in every area of our country. Our campaign is resolved to do that. Our campaign will do that. Thank you so much for everything that you do. We will win.
I would like to know what her husband was doing in A&E last night. Fighting with Brexiteers, probably, but who knows. Ladies and gentlemen, it's important to remember that this campaign is not cross-party, but it reaches every single part of the UK. England, Scotland, Northern Ireland and Wales. And our next speaker is the leader of Plaid Cymru in the Welsh Assembly. Please give a huge welcome to Adam Price.
We've already heard over the next few days we're about to witness a parliamentary tug of war perched on the edge of a precipice. Mrs. May wants us to abseil to a ledge halfway down where we'll spend the next 10 years in a sleeping bag tethered to the cliff face. Others want us to recreate Boris Johnson's famous zip wire moment, but this time, without the helmet, without the harness, even without the zip wire. Just two plastic Union Jacks fluttering in our hands as we plummet to our fate. Now we know that there's no majority for either of these two scenarios. Not in the House of Commons, not in the Welsh Parliament, not in the Scottish Parliament, nor, most importantly of all, among the people. They're asking for the chance to step back from the abyss. Not a rerun of the last referendum. In 2016, the question was based on a fantasy of false promises and contradictory demands. No, it's going to be a real choice. But our position, as Caroline was saying, cannot just be to remain. Who wants to remain in poverty?
Nobody.
In austerity? In injustice? This time, we must be the movement for change in this country. In the people's vote, when it comes, as surely it must do, a vote to remain has to be a vote to reform, to renew, to regenerate. It cannot simply be a vote for the Europe that is, but for the Europe that can be. A Europe that is social, democratic, decentralized, and diverse. You know, we'll win the argument. We will win the argument. I'll say it one last time. We'll win the argument. And we'll win it with a smile on our face. Not just because the facts are on our side, but because we have the better dream. For a new society, for a new politics, for a new Wales, a new England, a new Scotland, a new Ireland, a new Europe, a new world. You know, keep your eye on the prize, because it's a great one. The people are with us in increasing numbers. Let's win for them, not just the right to vote, but the right to rebuild, to create a different future, a future that will be better than the past.
Now, it's a real pleasure and an honour to introduce our next speaker. He's one of Britain's greatest actors, star of Harry Potter, Star Trek, and The West Wing. Please welcome Jason Isaacs.
I never thought I would be sharing a platform with Tory politicians, Tory grandees. It's true, these extraordinary times demand extraordinary measures, I guess. I don't know what I'm doing up with politicians at all. I lie for a living, and they... they wear ties, you know. So maybe I'm up here because I can bring a non-political perspective to this complicated situation. That's what I do. I try and unpick complicated people and complicated situations and find what's human and real in it. And God knows this is very complicated. A quick show of hands, who's read the 585-page memorandum?
586 or 587.
Four people, that's very impressive. I wonder how many of the MPs have read it, the 25-page statement of intent, and the reams of analysis that have been generated by it. And if not, then where are they getting the information from? Where are they getting their certainty from? Well, I don't agree personally with rerunning the referendum arguments. We have them, we made them, depending on where we were. Decisions were made, and it's pointless, because we're here now. Everybody, I think, and we know this, Eddie and I as actors, everybody always thinks they're doing the right thing. Everybody. Even the most monstrous people on the planet, they think they're doing the right thing. I played a very famous racist in the Harry Potter films. He's a white supremacist with an absurd blonde hairdo. It was very hard to find a parallel anywhere on the planet. But But even he, Lucius Malfoy, and the other person who shall not be named, thinks he's doing the right thing every morning, looks in the mirror and thinks he has the answers. So where did we get our information from? In 2016, depending on who you listen to, there was a vision of Britain that would be richer out of Europe. You know, that the European countries would be lining up to do trade deals, about the whole world would be lining up to do trade deals with us, and we'd go around our own ticket. You know, we wouldn't be hampered by regulations, by manufacturing practices. We could decide what goes into our own chocolate. That seemed to be a very big deal for a while. And crucially, most importantly, that brilliant shining jewel, the National Health Service, of which we are also rightfully proud, would have a massive influx of money. We'll be able to help more people. We'll be able to heal more people. And we'll have a right over our own waters, and nobody will come from another country and take our jobs and services away. Who wouldn't want all that? Who wouldn't want that? So, some people didn't. Some people thought that peace in Europe was made the rest of that stuff a price worth paying. You know, the continent that had started two of the most vicious wars in recorded history. And things descended into very ugly slanging match. Name-calling and finger-pointing, very un-British thing happened. It turned incredibly vicious, much like many of the Christmases I suspect we're all about to have at home. But that was then, and this is now. That was all fantasy and projections and promises, and now we know things. As much as we can ever know anything, we know facts, and we know that a lot of those promises were a pile of steaming wishful thinking, and there's a deal, a real contract on the table. And it's the result of painful and aggressive, protracted negotiations. Anybody who tells you they can go in and renegotiate something else is lying, and Europe makes it quite clear that they're not going to renegotiate anything. This is the deal. And everybody on all sides, as we keep hearing, agrees very clearly that the consequences of that deal are disastrous. There will actually be less money for everything we want to spend money on, to create jobs, for social services. There'll be less money for the NHS that saved my dad's life 2 weeks ago. The genius and incredibly compassionate and patient Greek cardiologist who found a leak in his valve will not be in this country, and his friends won't want to come, and his peers won't want to come, nor will, as you heard from Caroline, nor will the Italian nurses, the Croatian cleaners that I spoke to. The NHS will be in crisis. It's not a political point, it's a point made by everybody who works there. Process when these things aren't political, when the Conservative Chancellor says, yes, we'll have less money in our kitty. And when every independent think tank, every economist, anyone who has devoted their life to studying these things and predicting financial models tells us we will be poorer, and in fact, it's the poorest and most vulnerable people in our British family who suffer the most. Even the nice man who runs the Bank of England, he's Canadian, they're all nice, I married one, even he tells us that this deal and no deal will be a complete catastrophe. And we're a sensible family. Generally, our British family don't do extreme things. This is an anomalous experience we've had. It's been a disaster for all of us. We've had time to calm down over the last 2 years, to listen to each other. And I know this as an actor. Nobody wants to do the wrong thing. They all think they're doing the right thing. And now we have new information. And of course, everybody who voted Leave isn't a racist. Of course, everybody who voted to Remain isn't a member of some metropolitan league. That's all a pile of nonsense meant to divide us. Look at the cross-platform support here and across the country. There's a farmer's market near where I live. And I went this morning, every Sunday morning, my wife sends me with a very specific list of what to buy. And she sent me out for tomatoes this morning. It's a bit more expensive, the place. It's organic and we're supporting small farms. It's not a local supermarket, but we go. And if I came back, having been sent off a bag of tomatoes, with half a bag of rotten plums, and I said they charged me 700 quid and the car keys and the dog, it would be a frosty lunch. And that's where we are. I've watched the debate. I've watched the debate all day, Wednesday, Thursday and Friday. I've watched it in Parliament. Yes, I'm an actor who's not working at the moment. I had that privilege. And it's been horrifying. There's a lot of threatening, there's a lot of bullying, panicking. Our representatives are standing up, the people who we delegate to make these big decisions for us, and admitting that they don't know what to do, that they think that their constituents are inclined a particular way because of how they voted 2 years ago on a very small minority, but they're not sure. Well, guesswork and jostling for position and dogma have no place in this massive decision that we have to make. Sometimes it's an act that we deal with facts, that we deal with feelings, and sometimes it's hard to be objective and not driven by pride or resentment or shame, and none of that, none of the rancor of the past has any place in where we are now or in our future. We are where we are, like all families. We need to forgive, we need to unite, we need to move forward together, and this choice that has to be made, with enormous consequences for our country and for our children, needs to be our choice. We need to make it together, and I urge you, if you're in the room here, if you're listening, if you come across whatever I or anybody else says today, to make sure that your Member of Parliament knows exactly what you want. Tell them exactly what you think today about our real world choices. You want them to reject this ludicrous mutant of a deal and to give us our vote. Let us choose for our future. Have a people's vote. Thank you.
Jason Isaacs.
Thank you, Jason. Now, our next speaker is someone who has courage and conviction in bucket loads. He was the first minister to resign from this government. Please welcome the Conservative MP for Bracknell, Philip Lee.
So I get the graveyard slot as the only Tory following the charismatic famous actor. Thank you for that. I suspect that most of us in this room 3 years ago would not have imagined that we would give up our Sunday afternoons, time with friends and family, to congregate in a room and get politically active. I certainly didn't foresee this. But when I resigned in June, it was because I could see that this parliamentary impasse was looming. And I could also see that the country was on a terrible path. Today, I'd like to talk about the future and why I, a Tory, one of maybe 10 in Parliament, believe a people's vote is important to secure that future. The people's vote is about being fair, about being democratic. It should be responsible. It should be responsible, and we should seek the informed consent of the British public before we proceed with any type of Brexit. But above all, it will give the British public an opportunity to vote for a better future within a reformed European Union. Because I'm not in favour of decline. I'm not in favour of self-destruction, of a gross act of harm to our identity as a country and our position in the world. I'm not, and I know you're not. Above all, though, we need to do the right thing by everybody in our country. And in doing that, we need to focus beyond this vote. This vote that I hope is coming. Because we need to secure a future for us, for our families, for our country, and indeed, our world. We need to build a future together. Britain needs to become a leader in the world for peace, for prosperity. We need to be on the good side versus the dark forces of populism which are spreading throughout the world. We need to secure a prosperous future for all of our communities, our families, our friends and every part, indeed, every region of this great country of ours. And such prosperity, the fruits of it, need to be shared and spread more fairly. Such a bright future, I think, is in sight. And I think the people's vote is the best hope we have of reuniting our country after this sorry episode. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's grasp it. Let's grasp this opportunity. Let's take back control. Let's have a people's vote. Thank you very much.
Now, our next speaker is someone who's thrown his heart and soul into the campaign for a people's vote. Please give a huge welcome to the MP for Cardiff South and Penarth, Stephen Doughty.
Well, thank you very, very much, and what extraordinary times. And extraordinary times demand extraordinary movements. And that's exactly what we have in this room, it's what we have in every part of this country, it's what we have amongst our young people behind, it's what we have across our political parties, and that is what is needed for these times, extraordinary movements. And I just want to get this over and done with. I will be voting against that deal. And let me be clear, I'm a Labour MP, and I'm going to be voting against that deal because as a Labour MP, I will not vote to make my constituents poorer. I won't vote for fewer jobs, for more austerity, for less for our public services, for an attack on our employment rights, an attack on our environmental rights. I'm not going to vote for it. It's what my constituents are saying to me, it's what people are saying across Wales and across this country. And I'm also not going to vote to make my constituents less safe. We've heard a lot about the damage that this deal would do to our economy. We've heard a lot about the damage that Brexit would do to our young people's prospects. But I'm not going to vote to make us less safe. I'm not going to vote to lose access to those crucial databases that keep our borders safe, that keep us safe from criminals and terrorists. And at a time when I see young people dying on the streets of my constituency, and we see them on the streets of this capital from knife crime, it is an absolute outrage to me that the Home Office is spending over £500 million preparing for Brexit instead of 4,500 extra police officers on our streets. And Theresa May says that this deal is somehow going to draw a line, that people just want to get on with it. And yet it's her deal that would ensure that Brexit goes on and on and on and on and on and on. So we need to draw a line. We need to say no to the catastrophic no deal. We need to say no to her deal. And we need to listen to the will of the people today. And that is why we need the people's vote. I'm sorry to have to say this, we've seen some shameful and ugly acts and some shameful and ugly groups of people on the streets of this capital this morning. And let's be clear, they don't represent Britain. No. They don't represent this country. They don't represent the people of this country. And I'll tell you what, friends, they don't represent the people of this country who voted to leave. Because I know the people who voted to leave. They're my friends, they're my family, they're people in my constituency. And they had real concerns that we have to listen to and that we have to understand. And we have to be a movement that offers those people who voted leave in good faith and who've been let down, we need to offer them hope. We need to offer them hope about their futures. Friends, at the time of the Labour Party conference, many of us were fighting within the Labour movement, from all parts of the Labour movement, to ensure that our party moves in the right direction on this. And I shared a message at that time with many of our members, and particularly some of our young activists who were out there campaigning for that change in Labour Party policy. And I shared with them some words from Bobby Kennedy, and it was him who said, "It is from numerous diverse acts of courage and belief that human history is shaped every time someone stands up for an ideal. They send forth a ripple of hope, and those ripples build a current that can sweep down the mightiest wall. We have that courage, we have that belief, we have those ideals, we can provide that hope. Let's get out there, let's argue for a people's hope, vote, let's give the hope back to the people, and let's stop this terrible Brexit." Thank you very much.
Stephen Doughty! Folks, our next speaker is a hero of mine and a hero to many people in this hall. Please give a huge welcome, the Labour MP for Wakefield, Mary Craig!
Thank you, Matt. We have more in common than that which divides us. Joe Cox MP, my friend, in 2015. And what we have in common is the dream of our country as a European country, prosperous and at peace with its neighbours. The European Union, the longest and most successful peace process that the world has ever seen. But in the 2016 referendum, the people spoke, and in the north they shouted against a political system that saw one in four children in the north growing up in poverty, endless austerity. And from Wakefield to Wigan, from Hartlepool to Hull, they were fed up and they voted for change. But they're not going to get that change. After 2 years of negotiating, we found out the truth. The Brexit dream is a waking, endless nightmare. It'll hurt our towns and our cities, and in the north more than in the south. It'll hurt our people, it'll hurt our public services, and it harms the fight against crime and against terrorism. It threatens our wildlife and our hard-won rights at work. And Brexit means that landlords and employers will do immigration checks on people with foreign surnames. And that's not good if you've got a surname like mine. Deal with Donald Trump's America, are we really going to open up our NHS to American companies? I say no.
No. No. No. No. No.
Strange days indeed when Priti Patel says we should use the threat. Says we should use the threat of food shortages to force the Irish government back to the negotiating table. The Great Famine and Gorta Moor where millions of children, women and men died and millions more fled their country. A shameful chapter in British history, a reminder of what happens when Parliament is divided, bread is expensive and human life is cheap. We're not having it. The wheels are coming off your Brexit bus. I voted against Article 50, and I'll vote against Theresa May's deal on the future. On Wednesday, she should revoke Article 50 and...
Yes!
What should be on the ballot, but I'm clear, a simple choice, Theresa May's way or stay in the EU.
Yes, stay in the EU.
Theresa May wants to unite the country. Well, she has. We're united in condemning her rotten deal. We'll see Parliament taking back control, and we must give the decision back to the people. The day before she died, Joan Cox was on a boat on the Thames fighting against Nigel Farage's fisherman's flotilla. Her memory gives me the heart of a lion for this fight. Do you have it too? Yeah. Are you listening to me tonight? We demand a people's vote.
We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote.
Mary Craig! And what's so powerful about today and about this campaign isn't just seeing people of different parties come together. This is an amazing glimpse into how much better our politics could have been, yeah, and how much better it could be. And with that in mind, our next guest is very special and deserves a very warm welcome. Not only is she an NHS doctor, not only is she a Labour MP, she is a senior Shadow Cabinet Minister. So this is a big, brave decision to be here. She has chosen not to toe the party line, but to put her principles first. She's announcing herself today as the newest and latest supporter of the People's Vote campaign. Raise the roof, please, for the Labour MP for Tooting, Dr. Rosanna Allen Carr.
And thank you to everybody here today. It is through your persistence and dedication that this conversation is where it is now. I stand before you here today as an NHS doctor, as the Shadow Minister for Sport, and the proud Labour MP for Tooting. for Brexit. Local people first elected me in a by-election run just a week before the EU referendum. I stood on their doorsteps and asked them to put their trust in me, that I would have what it took to stand up for them, and where needed to, would find the courage to represent them. It is for those reasons that I voted against triggering Article 50. I recently launched a local Brexit poll asking people to give me their views on the Brexit deal. And today, I published those results, which are very, very clear. Over 2,700 local people took part in the poll, and just 7% of them support the government deal. 7%! Even fewer support a no-deal Brexit. But most importantly, 90% of Tooting people want a people's vote.
Yes.
Only 3% of Tooting residents believe that Brexit will help raise living standards or improve our children's futures. And it is our children that I worry about the most. There are hundreds of thousands of young people, now 18, 19, 20 years old, who were denied the opportunity to vote. They were denied. They wanted a say then, and they want a say now. It is their futures and my children's futures which are at stake here. And denying these young people a voice is something I simply cannot and will not live with. Less than 3% of local people in Tooting believe our NHS will be better off after Brexit, which is far from the promises originally made. Yes, the bus lied. And very importantly, as a doctor, my conscience will not allow me to stay silent while our hospitals, already in deficit, are having to pay for visas for EU staff because the NHS would fall to its knees without them. Silent while a workforce that I am proud to stand with shoulder to shoulder in A&E is suffering with emergency plans being drawn up to stockpile medicine. And I cannot and will not stay silent as patients with long-term health conditions fear for their future as reports circulate that medicine will be fighting salad for space on ships coming into the UK. Promises made in 2016 are so far removed from the reality of the 585-page withdrawal agreement that it's time to take the Brexit decision back to the people.
Yes!
But let me be clear. The last thing I want, the last thing our country needs, is a rerun of the EU referendum. It was a campaign which manipulated people's fears. And what was the result? The result was people being bullied, attacked and threatened, living in fear because of a campaign which blamed and marginalised them. I wouldn't want to rerun that for fear of what our communities would feel if that was repeated. Campaigns must be run on facts and not fears.
Must be run properly.
Campaigns must speak of a positive future, not a damaging race to the deepest, darkest moral cesspit where hatred rears its ugly head.
Correct. Correct. You cannot run a campaign with fear.
Parliament has a decision to make in the next few days, which will alter the course of history for the UK, for us and for our children. It will come as no surprise that I will not be supporting this deal.
Well done. Yes, well done. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Tutu.
And I won't be supporting leaving the EU with no deal. And when this deal is voted down by Parliament, I want us to call for a general election the very next day, and if that is rejected, then we need a people's vote. And do not let them tell you it's betraying the will of the people, because the biggest betrayal is that of our children, our hospital patients, our much-valued NHS workforce. We have had two general elections in the last 3 years, and nobody is telling us that they were undemocratic. The current government is run on confidence and supply. And let's face it, confidence in our current government is in very short supply. So, let's end the economic uncertainty. Let's end the fear-mongering. And let's have a campaign based on facts. If a call for a general election is rejected, I will be backing a people's vote.
Special guest in the audience. Look, you can see that Santa Claus is up there. Santa, give us a wave. Santa, of course, dead against Brexit and to the strict freedom of movement, which would be awful for him. Now, we all know that young people didn't vote for Brexit. They're the ones who stand to lose the most from leaving the European Union. So please welcome to the stage the president of the Student Union at the University of Kent and supporter of For Our Future's Sake, 23-year-old Aaron Thompson.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for coming out today, and thank you for having me. I'm honoured to represent the underrepresented the voices of the students and the amazing people behind me today. Thank you for allowing me to speak, mainly because words are probably the last thing we want to hear this week. We've had four marathon days of parliamentary debate, thousands of column inches written, millions of words spoken and heard, if not listened to. And whilst the words spoken were diverse and varied, the people speaking them were not. Those who are so confident about the botched Brexit deal and any other being put forward, they are posh and privileged old white men. They do not sound like me or my friends or family. They do not share my experience, nor do they share my struggle. Because as much as the Brexit elites claim otherwise, they do not represent the people of the United Kingdom. They don't see the climate of fear they've created, or share the concerns of the silenced generation worried about our futures. Because all of us with something to lose know that the Brexit we're being given is just that, losing. Losing power, losing money, and losing control. The students around the country losing access to opportunities, companies and jobs going abroad and limiting their cultural awareness. Now, Jacob Rees-Mogg might try and say Brexit's benefits will be felt in 50 years' time. I'm sorry, what? Theresa May could try and delay the meaningful vote again. Sounds like someone's scared to me. And Michael Gove can talk about Norway for now. Stalling, everyone. Ding, 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 stalling. Always stalling. Biding their time, waiting to get bored or confused, to rise up and stop to them. But the next generation, we won't stand for it. We are not standing in line for our futures to be handed to us like scraps off a table. Because we are faced with the fact that the tomorrow is today. We are confronted with the fierce urgency of now. The future is upon us. It is standing on this stage. It is leading the charge for our future's sake, urging MPs to vote down this Tory deal and making the argument for a people's vote. Because, everyone, together, everyone in front of me, everyone behind me, we can make our voice heard, we can rise up, and we can win. Now, you've heard from the next generation, now it's time to hear from an elder statesman. So please, give a warm welcome to the former Deputy Prime Minister, Lord Heseltine.
I am proud to be with you today. From that chill moment when a tiny majority of our fellow citizens had been persuaded by promises of a brighter tomorrow, regained prosperity, restored sovereignty, and a massive bonus for the National Health Service, they have been persuaded to leave the European Union. You knew it wasn't true. You led the fight back. I hope, in my small way, I stood with you. It seemed to me logical that if we were to regain control of sovereignty, the mother of parliaments should have a meaningful vote before taking an irrevocable step. So I defied a three-line whip of my party to vote for a meaningful vote. The Prime Minister sacked me. What's in a word? I exaggerate. She got the chief whip to call me out of dinner with my wife in Wilton's, and he sacked me on her behalf. I have only on two previous occasions, defied a three-line whip of my party. First, when my party proposed to vote against legislation in the 60s, which laid it as a matter of law there should be no discrimination on grounds of colour, class or creed. A handful of us defied the whip and our party changed its mind. Yes, yes, I got rid of the poll tax. So in the end, you must do what you believe to be right. And this is what you did. You stuck to your convictions. You put your belief in the national interest of our country above your careers, above your local loyalties, above any party political pressure. You kept faith. You turned your face to the storm. Of course, you paid a price. The Brexiteers, they called us traitors. I refute that charge. Are the British patriots. We are the ones fighting for Britain's national self-interest.
Absolutely. Well said, well spoken.
We want to strive the corridors of Europe where decisions are made as makers, not takers. Protecting the opportunities of tomorrow for our younger generation.
And today.
We are so proud of what this country is and what it has been that we claim our place at the heart of European power. Is their voice in Europe.
Yes!
We are heard more loudly across the Atlantic if we speak not just as the British, but also as Europeans.
Yes!
It is the Brexiteers who seek to belittle us, to undermine our influence, to slam windows, close doors with unrealistic claims of freedom and the delusions of sovereignty. Europe represents the self-interest of the nations. You all travel, I travel across Europe, and they will all travel across Europe. I have never met a German who feels less German. I've certainly never met a Frenchman who feels less French, because they are our partners in
Absolutely.
Europe.
Absolutely.
You will ask me about immigration. Increasingly, within each European country, the concerns grow. I believe that Europe will revisit these concerns. Indeed, I believe that here are the seeds of a new accord, which in part could open the door of our continued membership of the community. Immigration is no longer a European issue. The facts are instructive. Over the past decade, In every quarter of every single year, net immigration to the UK from outside the EU has exceeded the net immigration of EU citizens. Over that period, over 700,000 more non-Europeans have settled here than European citizens. So why were no controls introduced? Theresa May was Home Secretary for six of those years. And if she had wanted to prevent Australians, Americans, Indians and all the rest from coming here, it was perfectly within the free rights of the British Parliament so to do. Europe had no say in that matter. And the conclusion is obvious. The government introduced little control because they know the value these people bring to our society. We are partners with 27 other European countries. We share a vision for a better tomorrow. United together, we confront the fears that threaten us all. We're strengthened by a sovereignty that is shared and thus enhanced. Who today is so blind that he cannot see 1,000 years of savagery and butchery? Who can forget a history littered with the names of battles in which successive generations of young people went to die? That's what they look like. Decade after decade, generation after generation, century after century, young people sent to die. And we have now evolved into 28 parliamentary democracies inspired by the Schuman Plan, founded with the iron and steel community, established by the Treaty of Rome, and now today the world presence of the European Union. The communists in France and Italy, they've gone. The colonels in Greece, they've gone. The fascists in Spain and Portugal have gone. We have learned in the most painful way that the tedium of dialogue, the boredom of negotiation, the willingness to compromise is, at its simplest, a manifestation of civilization. As we have heard with such eloquence and passion from this platform today, we are British. We are four nations as one. And we want the guiding hand, the political skill, and the practical good sense of our country at the heart of modern Europe. We want it for the world's sake. We want it for Europe's sake. But above all else, we want it for Britain's sake. Position the names, that is exactly what the citizens of all those other 27 parliamentary democracies want as well. The most depressing feature of Brexit is its appeal to the elderly. The elderly who voted 70-30 to leave are being replaced by a younger generation who voted 70-30 to stay. I remember the young William Hay, age 16, pointing to an elderly Tory audience and declaiming, "You won't be here." He warned his party not to ignore his generation. And I say today, may his warning sweep the corridors of Westminster's political parties this week. If we now exclude them from the corridors of European power. We must stop between them a seat in an anteroom, whilst other Europeans make decisions that will affect them behind closed doors. Or we must not put them in the humiliating position of submitting their views in writing so that other Europeans make decisions again behind closed doors. And they must not witness British ministers and officials negotiating trade deals in competition with the European Union six times our size, offering bigger, better deals yet again behind closed doors. In one cabinet post after another, I have tried to build strength in our economy. There is no escape from one simple fact. Our strength reflects our position as a partner, as a member, as a gateway to the European market. Our aerospace industry is at the heart of one deal or another. Our motor industry, foreign owned, is located here to serve Europe. The City of London is Europe's financial centre. And anything that undermines that position, that erects barriers or encourages frustration, that hurts us. And that is why every economic survey of Brexit is negative. Yes, there will be faster growing markets on the other side of the world. Of course, we must go for them. But the right way, the sensible way, as the Germans demonstrate, is to do so from the strength of a powerful home market, the European market. And all those foreign-owned companies will, of course, serve the growing new markets of the world, but they will do so from local manufacturing plants. They will build their glitzy new office blocks for their service sectors there, and their decisions will be taken in New York, Shanghai, Mumbai, Frankfurt, Paris, and a host of other places. It is to those economies that the profits will be repatriated, and that is why that any cake left to us will be smaller and less palatable. The enormity of this tragedy is this week being played out in the Mother of Parliament. The government is using every device to persuade both houses to vote for legislation that on its own Treasury calculations will make the country worse off. Every government forecast, virtually every independent forecast, points to lower living standards and lower growth. Brexiteers, they laugh it off. They hide behind that omnibus excuse, Project Fear. What's in a few figures, they say. Nobody believes them anyway, they say. What does it matter if the economy grows at a point or two faster or slower? Isn't it just a game played by economic consultants, by currency speculators in the city, or the super-rich proprietors of most of our national newspapers? Well, yes, for some, certainly it may be a matter of little consequence. For others, yes, it does offer an opportunity to make a quick buck, The pound devalues, up go the value of their overseas assets. Billions of their assets escape across the exchanges at the touch of an electronic button. The pound slumps, the hedge funds pocket the gains they made by anticipating it. The champagne flows, the celebratory parties echo with their laughter. So yes, some may go, and some may laugh. But there will be no laughter in the darkened terraces of urban Britain, in the tenant farms of our countryside, throughout a deeply divided society that has seen our economy slip from the fastest to the slowest in Europe. All those people who voted in the referendum to escape the frozen living standards that followed the crash of 2008, the Brexiteers never told them in the referendum that the direct consequences of Brexit would be slower growth, not faster, less wealth, not more, lower tax revenues, lower public expenditure. There are millions of our citizens, some largely dependent on the state, many retired with fixed incomes, unquantified numbers, just about managing. All of them longing for an end to frozen living standards, deceived by the promise of £350 million a week for the health service, by a freedom based on economic assumptions that you can have your cake and eat it. I should perhaps reflect that such a theory had no place in the textbooks when I was at Oxford. And all these people, they were deceived. The Prime Minister campaigned in the referendum to stay in Europe. She told us then that it was in the national interest. Now she says it is in the national interest to leave. Black does not become white, even when pronounced from the illustrious steps of Number 10 Downing Street. No one can predict the events of this next week. Every news bulletin, every headline, every leak tells us of a government that has lost control. There are the first promising signs that a growing number of members of the House of Commons are prepared to assert the authority and sovereignty of that place. Our country's future depends on the decisions they are about to take. They should act in the national interest. There are thousands of us. There are thousands of us gathered here today. We share no political or party allegiance. The one thing we share is the one thing that matters, our belief that our first responsibility is to our country and the generations yet to come. That the privileges that earlier generations created for us must be handed on, enhanced, for those yet to come. Britain must be heard where our interests are determined. That means in Europe. And if we must stand against our party, bear the abuse of newspapers, even accept a division in our private lives, then so be it. This is an historic battle. There is no place for the faint-hearted. This is no time to give up. And we reject the weary pleas of the compromisers throughout history that just give in and get on with it. Public opinion is... moving our way. We can secure for our people the right to decide. The very strength that has brought us to the brink of victory is the best guarantee that we shall deliver on our promise. And so we call on the millions of supporters to join the colours and win the day. Their reward will be another referendum. Thank you.
Politics come together. Everyone we've heard from today is putting aside party allegiance and putting the country first. It's now a pleasure to welcome a man to the stage who needs very little introduction. He is a titan of screen and stage. Give you his welcome to Charles Dance.
Steps forward we have taken seem impossible until they happened. The NHS was called a pipe dream. The establishment voted against it 21 times. The fight went on until a final vote made it real. Peace in Northern Ireland was a moonshot. It could never be. Until some brave leaders took a chance on peace and people north and south voted for progress. Votes for women, civil partnerships, devolution for Scotland and Wales, the movements against fascism and apartheid, often opposed by the powerful but made real by the people. We came and stood in the rain together. Marched together, sang together, fought together, and now we fight again for our families, for our communities, for our children, because we want our future back. It is time for a people's vote on the Brexit deal. Because everything is impossible until we make it happen.
Crucial votes in Parliament this week, and it's absolutely vital that we all let our MPs know what we the people want. Many of the MPs you've heard from tonight have been incredibly brave. The issue is bigger than party allegiances, and it's amazing to see MPs working across party lines to put the country first. And it's amazing to see so many people not just attend the march in London but attend here today. Thank you every single one of you, not just for standing up for what you believe in but to try to make the country a better place. It's inspiring to see so many of you here today. Thank you. On Tuesday evening from 5 p.m, we will be showing the debates on the big screen in Parliament Square. So if you're around on Tuesday, please come to that, 5 p.m. in Parliament Square this Tuesday. Before we leave, ladies and gentlemen, please, we're going to get everyone who's spoken back up on stage. Give a huge welcome to all our speakers today.
demand a people's vote.
We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote. We demand a people's vote.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much.
Thank you for watching. Thank you so much for everybody who's joined us watching live. I tried my best and I hope you've enjoyed that. We demand a people's vote.
Where did you come from?
Islington.
Islington? Oh, yes, I can study at the library.
Oh, lovely.
Well, where? I'm just healing now.
Okay, lovely. Yeah. Thank you. And of course, Alice, Pastor Alice Mogo, Mr. Sam Ayo, Queen Kawa, Rodri, Jamie, and of course, Tata Ivan, Biru, Frank Agu, Olayomi, all the way from Nigeria, and people watching us from America, Gloria, Ada, Adikwe, Tonya Maka, and every single person. I've tried my best, and this is what it looks like. Talk about a change and a shift. It is absolutely amazing feel when you're here and you see all these MPs, cross-party, coming in together and speaking about the advantages of us being together in the EU. Until then, it's wonderful. Have a lovely Sunday. And great to have managed to be here with you. And it is definitely, we reject this Brexit deal. We demand a people's vote. Hashtag, it is a people's vote. Hashtag final say. And of course, if you've not watched the bus as well, keep an eye on the bus. I will be on the bus this week coming. Going to Brussels, keep an eye on that as well. I think it's from, I'll let you know. Anyway, thank you so much. That was absolutely amazing to be here and to just say we demand a people's vote, to join the rest of the people and to fight for the young people and the youth so that we are all able not to have any further restrictions in the borders. And as for me and my house, many, many thanks for every single person watching. Happy Sunday. And I did watch your question time in, was it on the
Parliament?
On the Parliament, well spoken. What's your name again? Yes, I watched you. Well done. Yes, well done. I watched you. Thank you so much. Yeah. Until then, have a wonderful evening. And it's happy, happy Sunday. Happy, happy Sunday. Until then. Thank you everyone for watching. And this is, look out for Tuesday. Let us see what happens on Tuesday. And happy, happy Sunday. Have a good day.